So in mid to late March, whenever there is adequate time, whenever the weather is good, whenever the soil conditions are favorable, it's a good time to go out and do soil sampling for all your fields. And the best two times, the better time, they always say, is in the fall, right when the season's over, to go through and do soil samples. That way you have them for the fall, or excuse me, for the spring, and you don't have to wait for those soil samples to be ready, you know, in the spring when you got to get in the ground. And so we typically do that. I also typically soil sample in the spring, some years, just to see how things might have changed over the winter, or things might have differed. And because we had such a rainy year last year, I expect that our there was a lot of leaching of fertilizer out of the, you know, the range of plant growth and root zone. So I didn't soil sample last fall. It was just too wet. It wasn't worth my time. Didn't want to think about it. So we're out here soil sampling all our fields today before we get some rain. There's a couple things you want to think about with soil sampling. One, you want to know what the debris is on your field. Make sure you can get to your soil. That's number one. Number two, you want to kind of feel the moisture of your soil. You don't want to send in a wet soil sample. You don't want your soil to be saturated with water. It could break down the nutrients or any of the organic matter that is sitting in that sample between the time they get it. So the fields are, they're wetter than I would like right now. So I am sampling, but I'm going to let the bag sit near a heated area for a couple days before I send them in so they can dry a little bit. Not ideal, but we're in a time crunch here. That's the thing in the spring, is you don't have as much time to do this. So what do you need to soil sample? Nothing crazy, but what I start out with is a sheet of labeled fields. I just label them this is 1 through 13, and then I have my own separate sheet that gives the field name, the acreage, and the crops being grown that year. And this just works for me. It's easier to write on the soil sample bag. But on the soil sheet themselves, they're going to ask you what the acreage is and what the crop is. And most extensions or lab services are going to have crop codes for all these different crops. So I can look at this and easily reference everything. It's already there. I don't have to deal with it again. So this also keeps tracks of all the fields I've done. The next thing you need is a sample bag. Some of them are pretty nifty and they actually tell you how to do a soil sample. So for you new beginners here, you can find these bags at your local extension, your lab department, fertilizer chemical companies probably around, have these, to give out. So any place that really sends soil samples anywhere or does sampling themselves will probably have sample bags, but you don't need something fancy like this. You can use a regular plastic bag, you can use a paper bag, whatever you want to do. The only requirement is, I believe it's about a cup or more of soil that's needed for the test itself. These have cute little green lines that say fill up to here, fill to this line, excuse me. But on here you'll see sample identification number. That doesn't have to be a number. I use a number. You can write the field name, you can write the street name, whatever represents that for yourself. The soil lab doesn't care about that. They just need something to reference that soil to. So whatever works for you is what I would put right here. And then down below, just your credentials, your information of that soil, or excuse me, of your name specifically. So along with that, there's two other things that I use. Three, maybe, my feet. Yeah, gotta walk a lot. We gotta walk a lot doing this because we're doing soil tests throughout the field. Another vital tool here is a soil corer. This is one of the shorter ones. They actually have a little bit of a shorter one. I think this is mid-size, excuse me. Then they have another one that you can use and kind of press with your foot so you don't have to bend down as much. I'm young, so this works just as well. It's got a little core there and it's got an open slot so you can bang the soil into. The last vital thing here is a bucket to put your soil sample in. And I like using little buckets because you're not collecting a lot of soil. You know, this might fill up not even a quarter of the way during your soil sample. So those are the three things. And I like to keep track of the bags I have, keeping them separate. Make sure they're labeled before you're going out there. If you're labeling them before, make sure you know what field you're using. If they're based off a number, you don't want to mess it up. Could cost you a lot of money. Soil tests themselves cost anywhere from probably $15 to $30, depending on what you're getting. You could be looking for things like, of course, your micronutrients is, and your macronutrients is, are your two main things. You could be looking for organic matter, soluble salts, nitrate tests, a few other things you could be looking for, different kind of metals and stuff in your soil. And it's all based off where you get your tests. So, over 1 acre, you want to do roughly about 5 cores. So using this thing, they always generally see over 3 acres. You want to do about 15 cores. I never count, but I always do more than the recommended, just because as you walk, it doesn't hurt to do one or two more in that path. When you are walking through your field doing your tests, you don't want to walk with your rows. You don't want to walk completely opposite to your rows. You want to work on like a zigzag pattern throughout your field. And some fields might be different shaped, might be oddly shaped. But I kind of walk as I subsoil. So subsoil is always on an angle. So I'll start walking on an angle and I'll just zigzag through the field. You know, I might be 50, 100 feet apart, depending on how big the field is. So you're not walking every square inch of the field, but you want to do a pretty even zigzag throughout the field. But the reason you're not going with the row is because a lot of, you know, when we fertilize or when we plant, you know, we're planting with those rows. So you might be soil sampling a single row that has a ton of nutrients in it, but 10 feet over, there might not be anything. So that could, you know, really alter and change your soil tests quite evenly. So you want to give that, I guess, more strategic walk through the field in a different path than you would normally travel. A soil core, you want to be getting anywhere from 6 to 8 inches below the soil surface. And really that lower 6 to 8 is really where you want to grab your nutrients. You don't really want to pull off the first 2 or 3 inches. You want to get a little deeper down because that's where the core nutrients are going to be needed for your crops. I think that's it. Let's go do some soil sampling. I'll show you how to take one. It's quite easy. So when doing your soil sample, you want to find an area of the soil that's either clean of debris, because you don't want to be mixing any heavy residues or any residues at all in your soil mix that can throw things off. So I'll either look for bare patches between cover crops and residue, like this, or I can take my foot and just do a quick scrape of the ground. So I'm getting below any debris or anything that could be on the top of the soil. So what we're going to do next is take our soil core and we're going to gently push this into the soil all the way, and then we're going to pull this out. And you want to be looking at a nice core like this. It's nicer if it's a little filled, but we're going to use all of this and we're just going to stick it right in the bucket here. And now we're going to go on to our next one.